Team neck circles right, ready straight. Team leg stretch left, ready straight. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the University Art Museum, I'd like to thank you for joining us for tonight's lecture with visiting artist Shaun Leonardo. Tonight's lecture is part of the University Art Museum's ongoing Critic and Artist Residency series, a program that brings important voices in the arts to our campus and community audiences. This program is sponsored by the FUNd Endowment at CSU. Shaun's visit is also part of the programming for the museum's current exhibition, Scrimmage, Football and American Art from the Civil War to the Present, in the Art Museum through December 18th. I first became aware of his work through the exhibition called Mixed Signals, Artists Consider Masculinity in Sports, an influential exhibition that traveled from the Los Angeles County Museum of Art throughout the country. The work commissioned for that exhibition, Bull in the Ring, which you just saw, can also be seen in Scrimmage and was for me a critical piece to include, anchoring a thematic section that asks viewers to critically reflect on issues of violence in sport. Throughout our Scrimmage exhibition, the museum is hoping to prompt important discussions about topical issues and expand dialogue across disciplines. Shaun's work clearly exemplifies these goals. It's difficult to introduce an artist with a long list of important national and international group and solo exhibitions, awards, and grants, so I'll highlight a brief snapshot of his background and accomplishments. Shaun Leonardo received his BA from Bowdoin College and his MFA from the San Francisco Art Institute. His work has most recently been featured in a much talked about and acclaimed exhibition called Radical Presence, Black Performance in Contemporary Art. This exhibition was organized by the Contemporary Arts Museum in Houston and has traveled to the Studio Museum in Harlem, the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis, and the Yerba Buena Center for the Arts in San Francisco. Shaun has been honored with a number of awards and fellowships, including grants from the Jerome Foundation, the Franklin Furness Fund, the New York Foundation for the Arts and Art Matters, among many others. I'm particularly honored to congratulate him on an award that he received just this past weekend. The Yerba Buena Center named him one of the top 100 creative minds in the country, a luminary who is shaping the future of American culture. Not only was he honored with this award, they also selected him as a featured panelist. Shaun has only been with us here at Colorado State for a few days, yet his insights, his generosity, his advocacy for social justice and important social discourse have touched us all. We are most grateful for his kindness. So without further ado, will you join me in welcoming Shaun Leonardo?
Thank you for that intro. If you guys wouldn't mind entertaining me for a second, would you all stand up real quick? Just to level the playing field, if you all just take a deep breath with me, and on the way out, fuck you. One more time. Fuck you. All right. Cool. You guys can sit down. Now I feel that I don't really have to be, you know, on this stage, that we're on the same playing field, you know. And I want to say, well, that's a tremendous introduction. I'm not sure that I deserve all of that, but before I move on, I want to commend Lenny, Keith, and the entire staff of this museum for bringing this show. If you wouldn't mind joining me in giving them an applause. That show is outstanding, and it's the kind of conversation that absolutely needs to be brought to a place like this, especially a college campus, asking these difficult questions about traditions that are embedded in something like football. But, you know, I know some of you go to the show or haven't gone to the show and you're like, you don't get it. And you see that video and you say, why would he put himself through that? And I know that you say, I don't get it. And I say, you look at me and you say, well, I don't get him either. And that's okay. And that's okay. I don't know. I'm coming from San Francisco where I'm on stage talking about shaping culture, to visiting with really passionate students to give them feedback on their work, to then talk about the Black Lives Matter movement and my work in that, with some students that don't even know why they're in the room. I don't know. It's a lot. It's a lot. It's exhausting. I'm exhausted. But I can tell you the one thing I do know is that I care deeply about the questions that I want to ask about something like football. You know, I played football for 10 years of my life in college, including college. And Bull in the Ring was a drill that was banned in the high school and collegiate level right around the time I was going to college. Now, why? An entire team would circle one player of the same team, and upon the coach's cue, the bull of the ring would be able to charge the matador in the center of the ring, and you could hit that person from any angle. And so it was directly responsible for a number of injuries, concussions, especially on the high school level, young kids getting hurt all the time. And I would say, as I said earlier, that, you know, I was too loyal to the sport to criticize it for many, many years. I couldn't touch it. You know, I've been on the field for 10 years, and I didn't have enough distance to really see my place in those traditions, or to look at it from a distance, to observe, you know, some of these intricacies and nuances that we don't pick up. But, you know, later on, I started to think of how that drill, something so overlooked, something that none of us as spectators would ever see, because it's only within practice, only enclosed within a practice drill, how something as taken for granted as that exercise, right? That exercise that's supposed to develop camaraderie. How that becomes a beautiful, beautifully violent metaphor for how manhood is conducted throughout life. You know what I'm saying? Whether it's in the military, at home, amongst family, in the workplace, we are taught that we have to at once exhibit our superiority and at the same time prove our worth and camaraderie in order to believe in brotherhood. To be part of the team, you have to survive punishment. That at the same time, you have to stand out and exhibit your strength and then survive in order to belong, right? That's crazy. And that's why I pull up this piece by Barbara Kruger. You construct intricate rituals which allow you to touch the skin of other men. And we'll come back to that. And so why would I put myself through something? Why would I bring back the bull in the ring into my life and revisit that experience? Well, it's because I see something there, and, you know, it was playing over in my head, and so I wanted to create a piece that kind of manifested itself like a dream or a nightmare, maybe a nightmare, where they were all wearing my college football number 23. They're all wearing visors, so it's more difficult to distinguish one player from the other. It becomes one mass body, one mass attack, a loss of individuality which singles me out to survive and belong, right? So I keep thinking about it, and football and my life as an athlete, my experience as an athlete filters back into my artwork so that I can ask the difficult questions about something as simple, something as potentially overlooked as Bull in the Ring, you know? But when I see, you know, I've been here for a few days now, and the realest thing I've said since I've been here was on a one-on-one with a student, not even in a crit, but outside the gallery, where when I told him, I can't even associate with the guys I used to play with. I can no longer consider them friends. Because my expansive view of my own identity and the fluidity that I allow myself within my own identity and in allowing to be more than one thing is something that they don't understand. And so when I see my friends or former friends that they can't turn off that aggression, that they don't know how to be a friend without puffing up, that they don't know how to be fathers, then I think we need to start asking some real questions. We need to start asking questions about learned behavior and how that translates and reverberates throughout life. So, I get too intense sometimes. I'm gonna back up a little bit and show you a little bit of a trajectory of how this all came into being, right? This is LC, El Conquistador. Can we switch the lights real quick? Yeah. Yes, that's me. LC was the first persona, for lack of a better word, that I took on as a performance character. In that performance, as a Mexican wrestler, I wrestled the Invisible Man, something that was inspired by Ralph Ellison's The Invisible Man. And as LC, my understanding of my own work, as this was the first performance, completely changed. I understood that in order to critique something, I had to do so from the inside out. That I had to actually become that which I set out to critique. And so, as LC, I wrestled and performed. This should be full screen, anyway. All over the world. But something happened while I was performing. I decided that I couldn't just perform, that I had to live it, understand it. So I actually started training as a wrestler, and I went to Mexico and became a Mexican wrestler. And through that experience, I understood that I could no longer pretend, that I had to immerse myself in the world of these heroes, of these figures, and really feel the psychology and pain that goes into representing someone like this. The hero type. And so I've trained as a Mexican wrestler. I've trained as an amateur boxer. I've channeled family history. And worn that bravado of Latino machismo, you know? I went back and revisited my experience as a football player. and as a coach. This is Battle Royal, where I locked myself in a cage with 19 other professional wrestlers, blindfolded, to see what would happen. I've also trained as a bullfighter. And I've trained as a mixed martial artist. You know, let's switch it up real quick before I get into this video. And so through those experiences, I got closer, right? I got closer to the belief systems that uphold these hero figures up on a stage, right? Those belief systems that go into upholding that sense of hypermasculinity and the ideals that go into believing in this construct of hypermasculinity, what it means to be a man, right? But by chasing those ideals, I could discuss and talk about failure. The failure that these ideals set us up for, whether that's emotional, mental, certainly physical, but also societal phase of failure, you know. But it wasn't until I entered into the heart of it, until I surrounded myself with it, until I became it, that I could really produce the work. The hard work, and ask those real questions, right? So going back to the Barbara Kruger, you construct intricate rituals which allow you to touch the skin of other men. You know, football is a game, but it's also a theater. Everything that happens in football is understood and completed by the audience. If I win like this, you essentially know what that means, right? What's that mean? Win. That I won, right? If you think of touchdown dances, right? And the bravado and all of that, interception and everything. You know, this is really understood, or maybe this is understood, championship belt, or even this is understood, right? That's easy. That's easy. We all basically get that. But there's also other behavior, other gestures that are a little more subtle. You know, just the way someone arches their back, expands, right? The way someone might lift their chin. So there's this coded behavior, this kind of motion, but then there's all other sets of things that are happening. It's a theater that we look at and believe. And so what I mean by coded is like there's all this movement, these gestures, these bodies in which masculinity is understood. But without an audience, football would be meaningless. We as the spectator complete those coded behaviors, and we root for them, right? So I'm going to show you a piece which I conducted in Haverford College with a number of students. Let me switch up.
Good. Uno más.
Set! Go! Fail! So that, again, that was a public participatory performance that I conducted in Haverford College a few years back. And the invitation was basically to a bunch of students, whether athletes or not, to join me in an abandoned gym and experience failure. Experience victory and experience failure. But what's interesting to me about those rituals and those exercises that we went through is that even stripped from the game, you essentially understood everything, right? That all of the, right? All of the, that's all coded gesture that we already understand and believe, right? In the suicide drill or the jumping up in the huddle, it's almost, we give ourselves as a spectator without thinking about it. We all understand it. And in that arena, in that theater, we complete the process, right? But when you're in the game, when you're giving yourself to the game, again, it's kind of this question of nature versus nurture, right? Like, how much of that warrior gene is actually there? And how much do we want to emphasize that and believe it, right? And celebrate it? I'm going to show you another video called One-on-Ones. And it's a little long, so bear with me. But I just want to ask you just to look. Look. And keep looking, okay?
Survive!
Fight! 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 Fight!
Thanks for watching, y'all. That's good. That was good. You did very well. It does require a different kind of watching. You know, that was a piece entitled One-on-Ones that I conducted with football players from Harvard University. And it is based off of a real drill, a drill called One-on-Ones. And what I wanted to do was, again, extract that drill from the field and slow it down. Slow it down to the point that it almost felt like and looked like sumo wrestling. Slow it down so that everything was executed by sound and that the ritual, that strange ritual, would be emphasized and that it would become clear, and that I would also force the players to face each other and look and keep looking and confront one another like you guys were forced to watch and look. Now, one-on-ones like Bull in the Ring is a regular practice. You take one player from the same team, take another player, and tell them to face off. The objective, push them out of a given territory and or completely demolish the person. So in my experience, that drill came into play typically right before a season started. And it was your way of earning a starting position. So it would be two linemen facing up against each other, two running backs facing up against each other. You get the idea. And so literally the object of it was to embarrass your teammate and earn a slot. Now think about that. Let's think about that. To be on the team, you had to at once earn a starting position and embarrass one of your own teammates. That equaled one another. That to prove your worth as a starting team member, that you had to completely destroy a teammate in front of you. Now, you know, it's, again, it took me a while to start looking at these things, but you have to start asking yourself. You construct intricate rituals which allow you to touch the skin of other men. We create these systems, these rituals that essentially, in order to be a team, in order to be a brother, you have to exhibit a certain level of violence. That as men, we have to go through a rites of passage that is filled with aggression in order to earn being a man. And so I think you need to start asking some questions about how this becomes learned behavior. You know? Because when I see former friends, former players, they can't turn off. That violence doesn't just flip a switch and then you're back to normal, you know? And so when we see in the media that domestic abuse plagues the NFL, we want to be surprised? And when I see men that can't cry, men that don't know how to embrace their own sons, then I think you need to start asking some difficult questions. That we learn that in order to be a man, you have to exhibit aggression and be violent with one another just to be able to bond, just to be able to hug. You construct intricate rituals which allow you to touch the skin of other men. Boxing. What's the first thing that happens after a boxing match? When the bell rings or a person's knocked out and gets up. What's the first thing that happens? Anyone? They hug each other. Is that a coincidence? Hell no. That you have to go through this cathartic, violent experience in order to express love, in order to bond with a man in front of you, you gotta punch them the fuck out first. Come on. And so we need to start asking these things. We need to start thinking about these things. Now, I don't know what to do about football. Football, I think, you know, is America's pastime. But I think as men, we need to start thinking about how we're being men. And I've said this once before, I think being an artist actually saved me. Thanks, guys. That's good. Questions, I guess. I'll just throw this back out. Yeah, okay.
How did you become an artist? Or what made you think, oh, I could be an artist in addition to an athlete?
and never was separate. I was never not an artist. And so my whole life was trying to figure out how to do both and how to be both. My whole experience was this dual experience of trying to figure out the gray area. And in college, it was the most uncomfortable. I was the most uncomfortable being that I could feel. I didn't know how to be one person. Like the way I was in the locker room was completely opposite of the way I was in the studio. Two completely sets of friends, two completely sets of behaviors, separate time, separate everything. I didn't know how to be both. And it wasn't until much later on, after college, that I figured out art is the perfect platform to mend both, to marry both. And it wasn't until I started incorporating my athletic experience into my work that I felt whole as a person, as an identity. I'm sorry, what's the name of it?
Men in Movement.
Men in Movement.
Yeah, so we do a lot of sort of redefining masculinity kind of things. Can you talk to me about, or maybe give some advice? I think there's some creative needs here that is sort of a right away. So what's sort of your process in terms of that mending process?
Well, I'm going to answer that in two different ways. I mean, my own artistic process, I try to start always from personal experience. So Bull in the Ring stems from a memory, a very vivid memory of having to do that drill. And one particular memory of which I actually survived until the very last guy who knocked me the hell out, you know? And so I start with being uncomfortable, right? I start with a question that makes me uncomfortable. I start with a personal experience that makes me uncomfortable. And out of that discomfort, I think, comes the work, right? It's only until you ask yourself the difficult question that the work becomes real and sincere and honest. And so that's how I go about it. You know, in terms of advice, one of the best things I ever read and heard was actually from a football player, was from Ricky Williams, I think. He said that the best thing anyone could do is surround themselves with people that make them feel good. That's the trick. If you surround yourself with people that allow you to be yourself and express yourself the way you want to and feel good, then you're on your way. Well, yeah. Well, I think we have many arenas in which we put on masks, right, in which we disguise our real emotions. And I should say that masculinity, like all other aspects of identity, in my point of view, is something that we try on, that we wear. And then it's like clothing. This I'm gonna wear this, doesn't fit so well, let me try this on, I'm gonna do this. And then, so we wear macho. We put that on oftentimes as a defense mechanism because we don't wanna feel vulnerable. We don't wanna let people in. And so we wear this attitude. We wear this state of being. We wear these gestures as a way to shield ourselves from the world, you know. I want a question from another woman. Yes. That I've thought about in my own practice? Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, I should explain that the work I've shown you is a bit old. And then, you know, well, not old, but it's in the past, you know, and, you know, I'm older now. I no longer train, trying to be nicer to myself and my body, and I'm married and stuff like that, you know. So the work changes, the work grows. And I think with that, in many respects, I agree with you. I think asking those questions through the disguise of sports, because it's something that we all know and all know how to participate in, that maybe it is the easier path to perform, right? Or at least to investigate. But I've also done things about my family and channeled that family history on stage and off stage. You know, I'm now doing work about police violence. And, you know, I think I've gone through a number of different phases, all going back to that essential question of how can we consider identity to be fluid and how is that attacked, right? And so my entire trajectory has been to make myself more and more uncomfortable and to ask harder and harder questions. And out of that, I know that real work will come through. But I will say one thing. My work is not ironic. You know, like I said, I did play football. So whether it's the bullfighting or the wrestling or the boxing, I could do those things. And I did them fairly well. And so I think the power of my work is that I could actually chase those ideals up to a point, right? That my work is a contradiction, that it's both fulfilling and accepting and an admiration of those things and a critique of that through the vulnerability that these images of power push onto you, create within you. And I think the reason that the work feels sincere is because I'm truthful to myself about that. I am those things, but I'm also aware of that and get to and force myself to question that. And so in that back and forth, you know, we're all walking contradictions. And I think that's where the real questions start to operate, you know? Shit. Got me. Well, I hope to have a son one day. That'd be nice. That'd be really nice. You know, I would really hope they didn't play football. I would do my best to steer them in a different direction, but of course that's the first thing that they want to do when you steer them in another direction. You know, I'm gonna answer that through the you know, side door. I had the opportunity of interviewing my father once for StoryCorps. You know, my father does not wear emotion. I've only seen him cry twice in my life, and they were both at funerals. No, that's not true. One was at a funeral and one was about something else. Like, this is a man that has worked three jobs to put me through college that didn't really grow up with his father. You know, his father, and I'm exposing a lot right now. His father, my grandfather, who I didn't really know, had five wives. And this in Latin America, that's almost like accepted. You know, that's a thing. It's something that you're bestowed and permitted because you're a man. And so I asked my father, you know, when this was happening around you, you didn't grow up with your father because that was family number two or three. And I asked him about this culture. I asked him about this ritual of just like being allowed to be to be with a number of different women at the same time. And I said, well, what makes that okay? And the first thing he said to me was, it's not okay. And I and that was the first time that I understood that based on his experience, he was figuring out how to be a father, because he never grew up with one. That throughout, the one thing that he knew was that he was going to do better. And so to answer your question, like the best thing that I could do is take what my father did and try to do better, right? And try to be, at the very least, open and allow myself to cry. Any other questions? Well, yeah, this is something that came up earlier. And what's the female's role in all of this? You know, I think women in my life have begun to surface in the work, but only recently. Simply because the work stemmed from such, you know, within my experience of sport and within my experience of macho, the work stemmed from a very particular place. My life as a man among men, and asking questions about manliness and masculinity. But I think you're right. And I think that question is spot on. That as you start pushing against the extremes of masculinity, out of necessity, you need to start thinking about femininity and the women that had an impact in your life, right? And so, yeah, I am not going anywhere. I'm going to be making a lot of work for a long time. And so we'll see. We'll see how it grows. You know, we'll see where it goes. Anyone else? One more. Let's do one more. I know someone has that burning question that's going to knock me off like Emily already did. Oh, we have two more. Okay, one and then two. Fantastic question. I always felt like an outsider, absolutely. And to me, that was my safeguard. That bit of discomfort and fear allowed me just enough space to observe what was happening around me. And so although I could be as much part of it as I possibly could and take it as far as I possibly could, that little bit of distance allowed me to be critical of it, even while I was in it. And I will say in this process and going through these really, like, listen, doing these things, it's not easy. You know, when I was training as a boxer, there were days that I didn't want to get out of bed. That your whole body, your psyche, everything is just damaged. You know, when I was training as a wrestler, and you had all of a sudden people start believing in this character, in this mask, and you have little kids coming up to you, asking you for your autograph, you're like, oh my, what am I doing? What is it? I'm becoming that thing, right? And so every single time, whether it was the bullfighting, it completely messed me up, completely ruined my psyche and body. Forget it. I mean, I've put my body through hell as research. But I will say that in doing and practicing and doing all these things, that the men in these worlds continuously surprised me, that they had much more to offer than I always realized. And that many of them were way more observant of their understanding and being as a man than maybe I would give them credit for at first. And, you know, wrestlers who project the biggest idea of hypermasculinity are the sweetest guys I've ever met in my life. But they won't allow themselves to be that out in the world. You know, of course, maybe in the locker room or maybe in small circles in intimate spaces, they'll let their guard down. So they don't know how to function out in the world. But they're the sweetest guys I've ever met in my life. And boxers, too. You know, there's this thing about survival and this thing about being able to really just beat someone up. That is a scary thing. That trigger is just frightening. But when you understand what brought them into the ring and how and why they keep doing it, your heart goes out to these guys. So I hope that answered your question a little bit. Yeah. Who hates my work? Interesting. Yeah, some people don't want me to touch these things, right? I get lots of response. I get a lot of feedback. Well, before I go there, let me tell you who often comes to me with joy, or at the very least is able to see to the heart of the work. I find that I get, you know, really often I get emails or phone calls from the athlete that was looking for that, one example, right, that didn't know how to shed this way of being, and they saw that there was a person coming from a very real place attempting to do it. So that happens. I think kids love my work because they love this idea of the superhero, right? And so, you know, I think the best thing that has ever happened to me is a kid came up to one of my works and said, "Why is it so sad?" And I said, "That's the work. You got it." That's it. I think older men of color often communicate to me and appreciate my work or tell me that they appreciate my work because there's a sense of struggle. And quite often, women that are self-identified as feminists really understand that when you push against the limits of a definition of masculinity, that you're absolutely doing the work of feminism. When you're loosening those strongholds of definition and of identity, that very much is the same strategy as feminism. Now, I think the people that hate my work, I don't know. I'm sure they're out there. You know, I would imagine, you know, I've never had anyone come up to me and say anything, but I've had people look at me, and I can tell that there's something in that look, and it's something about that they don't want to believe, or they think I'm coming from a false place. And I know what that look is. And more often than not, it's men. You know, men in their, you know, 30s, 40s, 50s, you know, middle age, that around, that are just like, they don't want to go there. Thank you guys. I really enjoyed this. I really enjoyed being here. Thanks.